CBS Sports is proud to bring you the Tour de France. Welcome to the starting line here in Berlin for the 2,500-mile journey to Paris. Hello, everybody. I'm John Dockery, and this is the Tour de France, the greatest bike race on Earth. The finest professional riders from around the world are gathered here. Now, most of the race is contested in stages, out on the road, in 150-mile segments. But today, it's what the French call the race of truth. Time trial, man against the clock, just under 4 miles, all by himself. Now, the Tour won't be won or lost here in Berlin, but a rider can set the tone and let the others know that he's ready. So the race to Paris begins here in Berlin. In the shadow of the Kaiser Wilhelm Memorial Church, thousands here to see the first stage of the Tour, the prologue time trial. 207 riders from 23 teams on a 3.8-mile dash through the streets of Berlin. For most of the 24 stages in the Tour de France, the nine-man teams ride together. But today, each rider faces the challenge alone. A test of nerves as much as speed. Solitary moments serve as private preparation for this first and shortest of the three individual time trials. A special start house complete with a short ramp is in place. The riders leave one after another, 60 seconds apart. Now this is an all-out sprint against the clock. So a carefully planned warm-up is a must for every athlete. The American 7-Eleven team uses a treadmill to help pump oxygen to their soon-to-be-tested muscles. An air pump does the same for the bikes. American Ron Kiepel, waiting for his turn, takes time to sign a last-minute autograph. Meantime, Czechoslovakian-born Milan Jurko, riding with an Italian team, starts early on. The early starters are not usually considered contenders. The fastest riders may start almost 4 hours later. But this day, Jurko burns the course with a blistering 7-minute, 14-second sprint, a mark which should stand for a full hour and a half. Ron Kiepel is now ready for his battle with the clock. His wife, Darcy, captures the anxious moment on film. The 27-year-old Colorado native is one of the founding members of the American team. People have seen the 7-Eleven team go from being the brunt of European cycling humor to a respected professional team. Though the distance is short in this first day prologue, the impression left can be a lasting one. Support car lets people know his split time and what he has to do to catch the current best. As Kiepel rides on, the American team leader Andy Hampton prepares for his date with the clock about an hour later. Ron Kiepel is one of the best time trialists on the American team, but on this hot, humid, sticky day, he arrives at the finish empty. His time not good enough to overtake the leader Jurko. Out of breath and exhausted and completely spent, he still finds enough air to ask his coach the all-important question.
No, my time was?
No. Many of the team leaders are still to come, including Andy Hampston, who wants to make a strong statement on this first day of the Tour de France. For people, a race a bit too long. His time 13 seconds behind the leader.
I died so bad in that last kilometer.
Did you?
The stars will soon be out for their battle with the clock.
Bike 150 years ago really was something quite special. It was probably the equivalent of owning a Rolls Royce today. And there was no shortage of imagination in design. And things in 1987, it seems, just haven't changed. German to produce the first of a new breed of speed machine, designers raced ahead.
Until about 8 years ago, this was the state of the art in Tour de France cycling, the regular diamond-shaped bicycle for use in all stages in the race. Now take a look how things have changed. This is the new bicycle now for all the time trial stages in the race, such as this afternoon's prologue time trial. You can probably see the difference. It's totally aerodynamically designed. The sloping top tube here, the upturned handlebars to keep the rider with his regular racing position, the flattened spokes is sliding through the air, the front wheel, in fact, 1 inch smaller than the back wheel here. And this itself was sheeted with graphite. Although the wheel is heavier, once it's rolling, it really does go quite quickly. The bicycle is shaped like an arrowhead, built for speed, because the Tour de France these days can be won by the fractions of a second, and this is a bike that might do the job. If you want to buy one at home, though, I'm afraid the price isn't quite so streamlined. It'll probably cost you in the region of $3,500.
The near 4 miles prologue time trial that opens the Tour de France is a short sprint, with each rider taking his turn. But if you miss your start time, you go when you can. Milan Jerko had set the target time, but then came a determined effort from rival Eastern Bloc rider, Poland's Lech Piasecki. There are no Eastern Bloc teams in the race, but a handful of riders have permission to race in the West. Piasecki, who won the world amateur title in 1985, was traded to an Italian professional team for a supply of racing bikes to Poland. Now with the fastest time, he seemed a good investment. But the stars are still to go. Andy Hampson from the United States. Laurent Fignon, the great French hope and twice a winner. Phil Anderson, the Australian fighting back from injury. Stephen Roche from Ireland, third, 2 years ago. This is perhaps the most important tour ever for Phil Anderson. He's anxious to prove that he can come back after suffering from hereditary arthritic disease in his back. Last year was a tough one for the Australian, and there were many who said he would never race this level again. But at least memories of a great career will help his return. In 1981, Anderson became the first Australian to wear the yellow jersey. He finished 10th. He did it again in 1982, and this time he finished 5th. So 1983 was supposed to be his year, but he was reduced to the role of domestique, the popular Frenchman Pascal Simon. A victim of injuries and politics, he's hoping now to make his return. Anderson's 29, and time is running out. France is hoping for a return to form of Laurent Fignon this month. Like Anderson, Fignon has suffered a serious setback to his career. He's fought against a damaged Achilles tendon throughout 1985 after withdrawing from the Tour de France. Then in 1986, a broken collarbone was another setback. This year, he has shown signs of full recovery, and the 26-year-old Parisian finished third in the Tour of Spain. Approaching the line. With the confidence drawn from last week's victory in the Tour of Switzerland, Hampson makes ready. While Vignon's effort is almost over. But his time, 27 seconds behind, is not so good. A last lungful of air. And to a cheer, Hampson launches into the race. After Greg LeMond gave the United States a first ever victory last year, Hampson carries a great responsibility this time in LeMond's enforced absence. The 26 years old from North Dakota has had a meteoric rise to fame after winning the Tour of Switzerland for the first time last year. Hampson is now on the American 7-Eleven team. But in last year's Tour de France, he was alongside Greg LeMond on the same French Lavie-Clair squad. Hampson possesses the most wanted talent of all, the ability to climb mountains and fast. He helped pave the way for Greg LeMond to win the Tour last year when he paced him in the Pyrenees, where LeMond moved to within 40 seconds behind the leader, Bernard Hinault. Finished fourth and won the white jersey of best newcomer in last year's Tour. But he became a star in his own right last week when he won the Tour of Switzerland for a second time. Hampson's aim this year is to be the first American to win on an American team. There's about to be a new leader as prologue specialist Jel Nijder from Holland sets the best time, and this will be his fourth prologue victory of the season. Hampson comes home with one of the best times of the top contenders for final victory. He's not really a time trial specialist, and he's anxious to prove to his opponents and himself he has the all-round talent to win the Tour. But his time this time is 20 seconds behind Nijder. The performances by Nijder, however, will not concern Hampson because he can't climb well enough to win the Tour. But Stephen Roach certainly can, and he aims to win the prologue. Professional in 1981 and won 10 major races, but since his third place in the Tour de France 2 years ago, he too has suffered setbacks through injury. But in Roach's case, no one doubts that he has fully returned to his best condition. But Roach is an Irishman now on an Italian team. Last month, he became the first Irishman to win the Tour of Italy, a race only 300 miles shorter than the Tour de France. And he did it despite aggression from his own team. 2 years ago, Roach heard all as Greg LeMond, an American on a French team, was ordered not to win the Tour de France and wait for Bernard Hinault, who's falling behind. Perhaps Roach learned then to look after number one. Start house is Jean-Francois Bernard, France's young rising star. But when the French look in the start house, they don't see Jean-Francois Bernard. They still see Bernard Hinault. Bernard finished 12th last year and admits he has still a lot to learn, and all France will watch his mistakes. Roach won the Tour of Italy in spite of hostility against him. But now, with a rare double in sight, he makes an almost perfect start and narrowly fails to take the lead in his opening time trial. Just Jean-Francois Bernard to finish. And his entourage, of course. Roach has made a supreme effort. There's nothing hurts more than the race of truth. And the clock never lies. Now it's Bernard's turn to finish, and the Frenchman has not disgraced himself. And in a last burst to the line, the Frenchman's time is only 9 seconds behind Nijder, who wins in his third Tour de France, his first ever stage of the race. Lech Piasecki of Poland was second. And of the stars, Bernard didn't do too badly, but Andy Hampson was only 20 seconds behind, Ron Kiefel 21. So, as the crowd gathers round to see the first yellow jersey of 1987 presented, a special star appears. Rather overweight, perhaps, but Bernard Hinault is still here. We'll be right back after this break.
When you think of Berlin, you probably think of a bustling metropolis. But Berlin is also a city of rivers, lakes, and canals, and parks where families can play. Berlin is also a city rich in history. This year, they celebrate their 750th birthday. In Europe, Berlin is a mecca for young artists, and a masterpiece just might be found painted on the sidewalk. There are elegant Baroque buildings reminiscent of another time when German royalty ruled the land. Very few of these buildings remain today. Most were lost in the war. West Berlin is what you might call an economic miracle. At least that's what they called it back in the 60s and the 50s when these buildings were constructed. And this is East Berlin. The wall built in 1962 still divides East and West. And reminders of those who tried to cross that wall. Berlin has its monument to peace, but its history is one of being torn apart by war. Adolf Hitler used the 1936 Olympics as a propaganda tool to fan the flames of war. Left in shambles by the ravages of the conflict. After the war was over, Berlin, isolated from the world, relied upon the airlift to feed its hungry people, its food supply cut off by a communist blockade. Just a few years later, Berlin was once again the battleground for the Cold War. The wall became a barrier separating ideologies and human beings.
All free men, wherever they may live, are citizens of Berlin. And therefore, as a free man, I take pride in the word, Ich bin ein Berliner.
At the site where John F. Kennedy spoke those famous words over two decades ago, the riders will finish their races today. Meantime, the first road race of the Tour de France starts with the 207 riders assembling in front of the Reichstag building, Hitler's headquarters during the war. It's a perfect morning in July.
Berlin is the farthest start point in the race's history. And after the opening prologue, the riders face the short 65 miles road race inside West Berlin last Thursday. A counterclockwise direction after starting from outside the Reichstag building near the wall. And the yellow jersey is everyone's target, and the man wearing it this morning is yesterday's prologue winner, Yel Nydum, who is defending a tenuous 3 seconds lead. There are no hills to test the riders, but the chance of $3,000 for the daily stage win or even capturing the yellow jersey, they could be the rewards. Stephen Roche is ready for battle with a crash helmet on. He's probably more interested in keeping out of trouble on an always tense opening day. Frenchman Laurent Vignon, a man who may be tense for other reasons. His poor time in the prologue didn't place him close enough on time to the yellow jersey, and he seems annoyed. Hey, Young American hope Andy Hampson has settled in quickly. And with youthful enthusiasm, perhaps, he keeps up a patrol of the pack, which is considerable now in size. Sunny day, the high speed soon projects the candidates for victory, and a group of eight men escape the attention of the pack. For a while at least, an alliance between rivals is formed. The Berliners watch, the pack race by, and they're over a minute now behind the leaders. The man with most to gain in this escape is Lech Piasecki. How ironic that a Polish rider was leading the attack in the shadow of the Berlin Wall. With 3 miles to go, Piasecki has the chance to become the first ever Eastern Bloc leader in the history of the Tour. And he wasn't going to let it go now. The pack is closing fast, but on this short stage, time is running out. Piasecki expects no help from the rest as they lead him to work hard to try and keep ahead. He needs just a 3 seconds advantage over the pack to make this historic lead. The tense feelings in the beginning prove justified as the field begins to fold like a pack of cards. Among the fallers but unhurt is Laurent Fignon, but he's quickly up and away. Even on the easiest of stages, these are the real dangers to potential Tour winners. The race is not particular when it chooses its victims. And for the Italian Alfonso Gigliani, his Tour lasted precisely 90 minutes. He's forced out with a broken collarbone. Ironically, up front, it's Gigliani's teammate who tries to win the stage. But right on the line and watch the left, it's Nico Verhoeven who gives Holland another victory. Piasecki is sixth, giving him the best overall time and an historic yellow jersey.
So the Tour has its first road race winner, a sparkling performance by Lech Piasecki. And isn't it ironic that the Tour was held in Berlin with the hope of cracking the Eastern Bloc to allow their riders to come to the West? East Germany and the Soviet Union declined, and now a Polish rider wears the yellow jersey and is congratulated by the Prime Minister of France in West Berlin. So after stage one, here are the top five riders. Piasecki on top, but not by much. The Tour contenders are biding their time because later this day is the all-important team time trial. And relaxing before the race are the Americans in Europe.
This is the way we spend our summer.
This is our collegiate trip to Europe. Yesterday was introduction to pain 101. Today was introduction to nerves 102. This afternoon, introduction to speed. Who has it and who doesn't?
This is CBS.
Texans are moving to Texas Commerce.
The auto parts market.
Take that turn. Don't follow the outside. So make sure you stay the inside. It's a small island in this turn right here. Okay.
The Americans check the course before the start of the critical team time trial. This is a race where all nine men ride together and share a common time at the finish. Weakness cannot be hidden. The faster riders will lose time if the slower ones cannot keep up. Andy Hampson knows his fate is in the hands of his teammates. Their time is his time. A poor performance could ruin his chance of winning the yellow jersey later. Last year at this time, the 7-Eleven team was basking in the glow of the yellow jersey. Alex Steda had shocked the cycling world by winning the second stage of the Tour 1 year ago today. That morning race had been the most important moment in cycling history for the Americans, and that afternoon, the riders were relaxed and happy as they rolled out of the Paris suburbs for their team time trial. Happy, that is, until disaster struck. team came unglued, splintered into separate parts, each rider trying to survive the near total collapse. The defense of the yellow jersey was all but over. Not like the way it was with the well-oiled European racing machines sprinting in single file, each rider taking his turn at the front to break the wind, the group riding faster together than any single rider could alone. Alex Steda, exhausted from his all-out effort to get the yellow jersey only hours before, became an albatross around the neck of his team as they tried to pull him home. Suffered the embarrassment of being passed by a team starting 5 minutes behind. So as the first group of six riders crossed the finish line, the American team realized that last year's Tour de France was really over for them on the second day of racing. They had come within seconds of losing their last three riders, including Steda, the trio just making the cutoff, which eliminates any rider finishing too far behind the leader. Change for these dejected athletes, and like the phoenix from the ashes, the American team has risen again.
It's going to be an American team out there that isn't just going to be this picture of struggle and hanging on to survive. You know, we got to be up there. We got to be dealing the cards this year. We got to be doing stuff in the race. And maybe that sounds boastful, but we have to do it. I mean, we don't have a guy like Andy Hampson on this team to not do that. And we're not going to leave him high and dry. There's too much talent, too much motivation, and too much to lose.
Like, Bob, the one thing you can't do is stand up on the front, because you accelerate without really realizing it. And when you went over that last hill, you just about...
Determined not to relive last year's nightmare, the American team stayed in California during the European racing season to work on the coordination and teamwork needed to battle their foreign adversaries.
It kills everybody.
Working together at home was a risk, because it kept them 6,000 miles away from the people they would face in the Tour de France.
So the thing is, just go as smooth as we were going, but just a little bit faster.
Total relax.
We'll do one more big lap and then come back here and stop again, and then we'll see about doing another, maybe a lap or two on the 5 mile circuit. All right.
Budget almost double that of last year, and propelled by a newly acquired $200,000 a year star in Andy Hampson, 7-Eleven had stepped into the big time of professional cycling. The skills of the team time trial practiced on the back roads and rolling hills of Southern California might make the difference in Andy Hampson getting the yellow jersey or not having a chance. Will soon be tested here in Berlin on the second day of the Tour de France. Tested against the likes of Laurent Fignon and his System U team, the same team which used their high-tech attack to destroy the Americans last year. Fignon talks with his coach, Cyril Guimard, a man who coached the last three Tour champions. The System U riders almost cocky, knowing they are one of the strong favorites in the team time trial. Their star Fignon searches for the power to lead his teammates against the stopwatch. While another team captain gets ready in his own way, Andy Hampson hoping the lessons learned in California will pay off here today in Berlin, and wondering if disaster will strike again. Fignon and his finely tuned racing machine are poised for their assault on the clock in a 25-mile course. It's System U and their rematch with the Americans when we come back.
The memories of a year ago when they lost the yellow jersey, still a nightmare they hope will never be relived.
Cinq, quatre, trois, deux, un, stop.
But first, it was last year's winners, the System U team, who set off along the Schlussstrasse. They are soon into formation.
Okay,
After a rest of only 3 hours from the road race, the route this time was a loop of 25 miles to bring the riders back to the same finish.
If we make a mistake, we can make a big mistake here. So if we make a mistake, this will be a big one, but we're not going to. So the better we do, the less danger we'll be in the race.
Last year, it was the System U team who demonstrated to the rookie 7-Eleven squad how to ride the most technically difficult stage of the Tour de France. Then they finished with a time 6 minutes faster, and the 7-Eleven team were all but last. This time, the 7-Eleven riders had other ideas, and they quickly fell into formation at the start. Lesson number one, three straight A's. Right, in team time trialing, each rider sets the pace at the front for about 50 yards or so, and then he falls gently back into a drafting position. With the 7-Eleven team, lesson number two, straight A's again. The 7-Eleven team were moving as a single unit, and if you want to succeed on this stage, this is what you really must do. Meters check, the System U team were ahead, but by seconds now, not minutes. Riding as smooth as silk at an average speed of 31 miles an hour, the 7-Elevens were gaining confidence with every turn of the pedal. Roche's Carrera team, the last to start, were fastest at all the checkpoints, and Roche, with the confidence every leader should have in his team, was content to just play his turn when it came. The time for the team is taken on the fifth rider to finish, so this way the strong men often have to wait for the weaker ones. This is truly a team event, and the one the team leader fears most. Has no such fears with his American team. The 7-Elevens are doing just fine. Phil Anderson and his Panasonic team used to win every team time trial in the Tour de France in the 1970s, but now they force the pace just to limit their losses. The line, the winners last year were on course again for the top spot. They sprinted over the line with the best time for the 25 miles to take the lead. Charlie Motte, the little Frenchman with the big heart, was tired, thirsty, but reasonably happy. The 7-Eleven team were now a lethal machine in full flight. No weak men, and that makes a real team. Toshiba, the team that Andy Hampson left this season, didn't seem to be faring any better, or indeed much worse. And one American boy's dream of bringing his own American team to the Tour de France was becoming stylish reality. Carrera team still were dictating the race pattern and posting the best intermediate times, and they even looked to be going quicker. But at the finish, 7-Eleven headed down the home straight, looking like the professional team they had now become. Sprinting for the line, the team finished at a time only 45 seconds slower than the System U team, and for the moment, the second best time. Not far from the finish, the Carrera team was setting an unbeatable pace and would win the stage. But this day was a triumph too for the 7-Eleven team, who really joined the elite.
God, I think we made up for last year. Oh man, that was a really good effort. Nobody's gonna make fun of us now. No way. No way.
And at the end of a long day, Lech Piasecki keeps his yellow jersey. The Pole, though, having to share the day's honours with the Carrera team. And Stephen Roche, who is prepared to wait for the chance he hopes lies ahead.
The whole team's together. We're thinking about, we're going to unleash in the last week. That's still 3,000 kilometers away.
But keep it more steady. Instead of win and then get last, let's try to keep it smoother in the first couple weeks. Eliminate that roller coaster.
Ooh. And then start winning.
And then at the last week, start swooping a dude.
For Lech Piasecki of Poland, an historic day came to an end. He led by 13 seconds. And of the other stars, it really was a story of Andy Hampson of the United States, who minimized his losses and was in real contention now. Who would want to buy a bike you can't even ride? Or queue up at 7 o'clock in the morning? Even get dressed up in the finest of clothes just to receive a flag from three overweight gentlemen who never speak to anyone. And there's the star, Lech Piasecki, a Polish man in Germany riding the Tour de France who speaks Italian. And he may wonder why an Irishman called Roche is getting more attention than he does. After all, Roche doesn't have the yellow jersey, but he does speak French. And for Andy Hampson, well, he's the highest paid American. He's even paid to wear the sunglasses. But it's quite a different story for Piasecki.
In order for me to ride the tour, my sponsor, Colnago, had to give the Polish Cycling Federation 60 bicycles.
Now then, let's see. Where exactly are we?
Between these two cowbands.
You go from Eppingen to Kleingard. See there, East Kleingard it says?
Uh-huh.
And then you go like this. Is...
But for the riders, it's easy. You just follow the arrows. And life in the pack is not always spent with your nose just above the front tire. Life can be quite fun early on. It almost makes you wish you were riding, doesn't it? Jeff Pierce shows his new style of headgear as he thinks of the 137 miles between Karlsruhe and Stuttgart. It's going to be quite a day. In the Tour de France, there's always those who can't stop trying to lead the race. And halfway through the day, 22 men take a lead. In this game of tactics, mistakes can and are made. And although 7-Eleven's Dag Otto Lauritsen is here, the presence of danger men like Eric Mackler from the Carrera team and the Frenchman Charlie Motte should be ringing warning bells. Even Phil Anderson, he's not here just for the ride. The speeding group work well together and rapidly gain time. And the blackboard man commuting between leaders and pack indicates they lead by 2 minutes 20 seconds. But in the last 9 miles, the leaders split on the hills around Stuttgart. And Mackler, in his fifth Tour de France, is looking to win his first leader's yellow jersey as he speeds away with Arcacio da Silva of Portugal. The rest of the front group now trail the two by 30 seconds. But that's nothing compared with the 6 minutes that Lech Piasecki, the leader, and the rest are now behind. Piasecki has lost out to teamwork, and there's no one here in the pack willing to pick up the pace. This was a strategy planned by the Carrera team. Mackler started the day in fourth place, 20 seconds behind, the ideal man, of course, to head an attack for the lead. Da Silva was more concerned with the stage victory. This way, both have something to show for the day's work. Chasers kept going, but they knew that this day belonged to the two in front. among the motorcycles, Mackler keeps up the pressure towards his yellow gold. All the Stuttgart were out to see the first visit of the tour, and the result was turning out to be quite a surprise. Finished as Silva wins his first ever stage. It appeared that in return for help in the pacemaking, Mackler was happy to see him take it. The next group arrived almost a minute later. So, for the third day, an unlikely name was in the yellow jersey. And for the first time since 1952, a Swiss rider was in front. Mackler had almost 6 minutes. And behind, the race favourites had made their first real mistake. Time will tell just how serious. Mackler is first, but the real dark horse to win the race overall is Frenchman Charlie Motte, who is now fifth. And among the favourites, all have lost time, but they are still close to each other. But are they worried about the gap?
For the moment, it concerns me just about, but if any more riders get away like yesterday, or if any of the riders that were away yesterday get away again, then it concerns even more.
System U made out pretty well with Motte and Matteo being up there. Motte might be dangerous later, but I'm not real worried.
And this afternoon, in wonderfully sunny conditions, the Tour de France, after four racing days and 225 miles, finally came home. It crossed the borders between Germany and France. It was a day when Stephen Roche, you wouldn't forget yesterday, patrolled the pack to make sure no one else escaped. And for the yellow jersey of Eric Mackler, he was a captive. He never attacked all day. But the accidents go on. A mistake by someone, and they're all down once more. The whole field was glad to be back on the road to Strasbourg. And the Carrera team were on their best guard, thinking of keeping this man in yellow for a while yet. Andy Hampson, on his best behaviour, neither he nor anyone else attacked today.
So the Tour de France has entered its native land, where it will stay for the next 3 weeks. No change in the standings, really. Eric Mackler held on to the yellow jersey. With Andy Hampston and his American team still very much in contention. Next Sunday, we'll be in the wine country of Bordeaux to bring you more of the greatest bike race on earth, the Tour de France. For Phil Liggett, I'm John Dockery.
And so the wine country that we'll catch up with the tour 1 week from today. I'll have a special report on the magical craft of the French winemakers, but that's not the only action we'll uncork. We'll be in Bordeaux for some vintage boxing. Wayne Thomas.
Week two of the Tour de France, and the heat is on. It's anyone's race as Le Tour rolls into Bordeaux. And in the heat of battle, nerves are frayed and tempers flare.
This is the look of Bordeaux, world-renowned for its great wines and the beautiful chateau where they are made.
The American tourists are back this summer, enjoying the sights and tastes of La Belle France. And we are happy to be here to share some of those with you on this edition.
The scene near the finish line hours ago in downtown Bordeaux as the Tour de France ended its latest stage and capped off what has been an unpredictable and tumultuous week of racing. Our John Dockery and Phil Liggett will bring you up to date on the latest from the wide open Tour de France when Sports Sunday continues from Bordeaux, France, here on CBS.
CBS Sports Sunday is sponsored by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. Kellogg's Corn Flakes. What more could you want from a cereal? And by Kemper and the independent insurance agents who represent us. Once you compare Kemper, you'll ride with us.
If you can't stand the heat,
get out of the Tour de France.
If you can't ride your bike on the road, carry it across a field. If your body can't take the strain, the Tour will provide a ride. Tempers are as hot as the blistering heat. Even the bikes of steel are cracking under the pressure. All for a chance just to touch the immortal yellow jersey. Cycling machine System U with their high-tech attack is armed with a double-barreled assault with emerging star Charlie Motil. Also threatening is two-time Tour champion Laurent Fignon. They have their own designs on the yellow jersey in a Tour still searching for a leader. To the Tour de France. This intersection of D94 and D32 here in Yerres, France, may seem insignificant to you folks, but it has a lot of meaning in this year's Tour de France because it's the only spot the riders will see more than once. When they come by 2 weeks from now, Paris in the coveted yellow jersey will only be about 20 miles away. But today when they come by, they'll still have 2,000 miles left on their journey, down through the wine country of Bordeaux, and then the perilous mountains, the Pyrenees and the Alps, and some of the toughest climbs on this planet. So before the glory of the Champs-Élysées, these riders will have to survive 2 weeks on their bicycles and a rigorous journey across France. A journey which began 2 weeks ago in Berlin, the most distant point ever for a Tour start. In the center of the city, the Tour began with a prologue time trial. A short sprint and the first chance for a rider to emerge from the pack. Of the stars, 27-year-old Stephen Roche would have the best time in this first of 26 races. The Irishman, now living in Paris, seems totally recovered from his knee surgery of last year. The Tour would spend 4 days in Germany before a large crowd, most of whom had never seen the great race before. And ironically, a Polish cyclist would lead the race in this divided land. Lech Piasecki wore the yellow jersey, which goes to the rider with the best overall time. Easily the biggest early test for Andy Hampson at 7-Eleven was the team time trial. 9 men against the clock, critical for a team leader like Hampson because the team time is his time. Last year, Laurent Fignon and his System U machine destroyed the American. Not so last week, when System U only beat 7-Eleven by seconds and not minutes. The American team had passed their first test against their more experienced European rivals and had done it with high marks. From Berlin, a short flight over East German territory to Karlsruhe, West Germany, then on to Stuttgart. It was here that Charlie Mote broke away from the stars, leaving them far behind. But the real story was Stephen Roche's teammate, Eric Mackler. His pursuit of the yellow jersey here would later haunt the Carrera team. As Eric Mackler headed to the finish line, his pursuers were still out on the streets of Stuttgart among the thousands of cheering crowds. And when it was over, it was Eric Mackler, the first Swiss rider in 30 years to wear the Golden Fleece. It was 1 week ago today that the Tour came home, crossing the border into France, where it would stay for 3 weeks. From Strasbourg, the rolling caravan continued west through Champagne country and races we will highlight today. It passed just below Paris before turning south to Bordeaux and some of the finest vineyards in the world. Here the course is flat, the heat intense. Further south and finally to the Pyrenees in the first mountain. The Pyrenees, the natural border between France and Spain. And as if the Pyrenees weren't enough, the Alps come next with some of the toughest climbs ever in the 74 years of the Tour de France. Finally, it's north to Paris and the Champs-Élysées, where the winner will wear the yellow jersey after riding for almost a month and 2,524 miles in 26 days. And the question this year, with Greg LeMond still in California recovering from his hunting accident, who will replace last year's champion as the best rider in the world? Will it be America's best hope, Andy Hampston? He's already suffered a crash and is finding the Tour tough from the very start. Race favorite Stephen Roche has been spending his final moments before races in an ambulance trying to relieve some stubborn muscle spasms. Laurent Fignon, winner of the Tour in 83 and 84, has been recovering from serious injury the last few years. He seems to be slowed down by a nagging cold. One has to wonder if a healthy upstart can seize the opportunity to win, and Charlie Mote may be just the man to do it. An unusually tough early test may give us some answers when we come back.
There's no doubt that everybody who rides the Tour de France wants to wear the leader's yellow jersey, even if it's only for one day. And the sponsors of the team, too, demand this from the team because they want the publicity. Take this last week, for example. Eric Mackler of Switzerland has been leading for the Italian Carrera team. But he, they say, is not the rider who can win the Tour. And yet the team has spent an enormous amount of energy keeping him in yellow. And at the same time, Stephen Roche, the rider they believe can win the Tour, has had to defend when he should really be thinking of saving energy for the mountains of the Pyrenees and the Alps. It's quite true to say that the pressures on the individual rider are enormous, and some of them, you know, simply can't take it.
Eric Mackler is the first Swiss rider to wear the leader's yellow jersey since 1953, and he intends to keep it for as long as possible. But this may be bad news for Ireland's Stephen Roche, who finds his Carrera team committed to help a man who in the end hasn't the all-round ability to win. How to dislodge Mackler is the question of the day, and plans are made. It's time for Frenchman Charlie Mote, the Tour's dark horse, to come out into the sun. There's also Laurent Fignon, twice a winner. But he's still searching for those halcyon days. Right now, appearances are more important. And there's Andy Hampston, still seen as the next American winner of the Tour. The thought of the yellow jersey haunts him daily, but it doesn't always show. But on this warm morning, the Tour de France is about to deliver yet another surprise in this intriguing game of bluff. And Mexican Raul Alcala aims to become the name on everyone's lips. And that's because today's stage between Strasbourg and Epinel of 106 miles is mountainous for the first time, and Alcala is a climbing specialist. He joined the American 7-Eleven team last year, and he's the only Mexican rider ever to ride the Tour de France. It hasn't taken him long to become infected with Tour fever. The only cure is a yellow jersey. Survivors of this 2,500 miles marathon are in buoyant mood this morning as they set off due west towards Epinal. After a week in Germany, the Tour has come home. So far, no Frenchman has won a stage or even led the race. So once out of town, the pressure was applied. This was not going to be just another day in the Tour de France. After the start, the attack started and the gap began to open. Only a few miles out of Strasbourg and already the day's pattern was taking shape. And it would be quite a day in the life of Mexican Raul Alcala. Back in the pack was happy enough as his teammates from Mexico went off in search of regaining time he'd lost so far. Eric Matzler would need more than just water to keep him cool this day. The 10-men breakaway was heading for the slopes of the Vosges Mountains, and the early attack had surprised the slumbering main field. They would pay heavily for their error. Miles out, and the group is already 58 seconds in front. And encouraged by the early gains, the breakaway works well together. But behind, for some, there are more important things to worry about, like just keeping up with the pack. Christophe Levan is in the break. He's only 3 minutes 29 seconds behind the yellow jersey. Alcala is next best placed. He's 5 minutes 57 seconds back. It's too early for the man to think of victory. It's just time to keep cool. It's not unusual for the race to be under attack so soon, but there's plenty of time yet to straighten things out. Alcala wasn't up front to waste energy. He had no intention of losing the advantage the leaders had worked hard for. He's a climber, and the gentle hills of the Vosges suited his style. Behind, Alcala's 7-Eleven team have moved to the front and pissed off Levan's System U squad. The strategy was to discourage the pursuit and give the leaders as much time as possible to gain it. The Tour de France is not always easy, especially when no one is sure now who's calling the tune. Certain now that the attack is a serious attempt to take Matzler's yellow jersey, the Carrera team take up the chase, but no one else is willing to help. That's the penalty when you lead the Tour. Trapped in the field, Matzler has more than just thinking to do now. Alcala's second Tour de France, and he's on the 7-Eleven team to help Andy Hampston win the race. This is no double cross. It's better to have two men near the top than one. The bunch is mostly together as they approach the top of the first climb, but some were in desperate trouble at the back.
Behind the pack, two riders from the newest of the 23 teams in this year's race, Graham Jones and Paul Watson, part of the first ever British team at the Tour de France. And on their very first climb, the British riders suffering 15 minutes behind the pack. This was a controversial journey for the British because many in England believed the British team for the Tour had been assembled in haste. But the British were determined to be here this year to commemorate the 20th anniversary of Tom Simpson's death. The great British cyclist died in the Alps during the 67 tour. Even a friendly push wouldn't help Watson and Jones make it to next Sunday's memorial service on Mont Ventoux. They would become two more victims of the Tour de France.
So on the Tour de France's first full day on home soil, it's a Mexican, Raul Alcala, who's giving everyone food for thought. Riding like a veteran of many tours, the normally always smiling Alcala is in serious mood as he fuels up for the crucial miles that still lie ahead. His main rival for the leader's yellow jersey is young Frenchman Christophe Levenne, forced to become a professional early because his parents couldn't afford to keep him at home. The biggest fear of tour riders is to become hungry and see all the efforts wasted. Table manners have no place here. This has now become the greatest chase since the tour began, or perhaps it should be called the greatest escape. Is now 5 minutes 34 seconds. This breakaway has never faltered, and after a steady start, the escape has developed into a battle between a Frenchman and a Mexican, and both want the yellow property of the Swiss rider Eric Mackler. Now the alarm bells are ringing loudly, and the Carrera team are brought to the front to try and save the day. With no friends in the pack, the team begin to work hard to repair the damage. Of an auto mechanic, Alcala was discovered in a local Mexican race, and he was imported to America to become a professional cyclist. The Carrera team continues to pull together, and Mackler himself is going to have to help if the yellow jersey is to hang on his bedpost tonight. Only Stephen Roach, the team leader, is not helping in pursuit. The gap is now 7 minutes 59 seconds. With such a lead, Levenne is the new leader on the road. He started the day only 3 minutes 29 seconds behind. Alcala is the next best place. If he could slip Levenne, he could lead the race. It's been a good day too for Andy Hampson, because he's drafted along in the bunch, while the Carrera team has been forced to waste energy chasing down Hampson's teammate. Doesn't seem too worried, but it may be Laurent Fignon, another possible tour winner, who will be having the last lap. He knows it's Roach's teammates who are having to chase down one of his men up front. So this has become a nightmare day for the Carrera team. They feel the full responsibility of leading the race, and as time ticks away, the yellow jersey begins to look fallible. To wonder now why one team spends so much energy trying to keep the lead when it could cost Roach the race later. The final cards in this game have not yet been played. We'll be back. And so, as the Tour de France snaked its way towards Épinal, the Carrera team had at last begun to close in. And this was the signal for Christophe Levenne to go ahead of the leading group and bid for the yellow jersey. This was Raul Alcala's only mistake of the day. He should have marked Levenne, then he wouldn't have had to chase so late. After a day of working together to beat the rest, two men now become bitter rivals. And the best pursuit in this year's Tour de France is on. Levenne, 23 years old and never a stage winner nor holder of the Golden Fleece, is told of his advantage over Alcala and the field. It's 47 seconds with the pack closing at 4:20. Alcala's also worried about the pursuit behind. He's in no man's land and needs all the encouragement he can get now from his team car. Alcala must now show the resistance over these final miles that makes the difference between the good and the great. But with the experience of three tours, Levenne is also coached by Cyril Guimard, the best manager. Advantage Levenne. The Carrera team are still all alone in pursuit. The lead is crumbling, but at what cost in the days to come? Mack Lapper is now within seconds of saving his yellow jersey, when earlier the loss seemed inevitable. The Tour was at its most angry now. On the first day of the Tour, on home ground, a Frenchman was fighting for the yellow jersey. What could be better? This was certainly Levenne's finest moment. Alcala continues to chase. The Mexican star was shining brightly. He was still set to finish second. But the Carrera team had closed the gaps, and neither Alcala nor Levenne will be in yellow tonight. The Italian team had won the day, but what a pursuit. Then, on the narrow roads approaching the finish, the field crashed. The followers were paying the price, were not helping the Carreras. Even Andy Hampston was down, but unhurt. The delay, however, helped Levenne keep up his escape, and Alcala kept his lead for second place. Hampston fell into a ditch and wrecked his bike and had to look to his nearest teammate, who happened to be Davis Finney. He took Finney's bike, leaving him to take a wheel and rejoin later. Teamwork takes strange turns in the Tour. And now it's Finney's job to catch up, if he can. Hampston safely ahead. Finney's left to pick up the pieces. At the finish, there's a great cheer for Christophe Levenne, who wins his first ever stage of the Tour de France. Behind, the Carrera team still head the reassembled pack. They're heading for home now. The team has saved the day for the man in yellow. Alcala never caught Levenne, but he showed the tenacity of a great fighter by staying ahead of the rest for second place. It's a performance that will prove to Hampston he now has a strong ally. When the pack arrived, the Carrera team had excelled, and the pursuit, which lasted all day without help from anyone, had paid off. The Tour had also found itself another name too, Raul Alcala. It'll be fiesta time in Épinal tonight. So at the end of day six, Levenne failed by just 36 seconds to take the yellow jersey from Eric Mackler. And for the moment, the real stars keep their back seat, while Hampston recalls the crash.
It happened real fast, but boy, a lot of people went down. When I got up, I was pretty confused just from tumbling around at 30 miles an hour, and I couldn't find my bike, and I was kind of in a panic to get going again. But Davis Finney was right there, so he gave me his bike and shoved me on the way, and then Jeff Bradley brought me halfway up the pack, and Jeff Pierce brought me all the way to the front. Once I got there, Boyer kind of nursed me all the way in.
While Hampston and his 7-Eleven teammates were working to survive crashes, the Carrera boys were loose and happy to have one of their own, Eric Mackler, with the yellow jersey. But what does their star, Stephen Roche, think about having the lead this early in the Tour?
For me, it will by far, but I'm not the boss.
But you'd unload it if you could?
Oh, definitely. Not so much to unload it, but it's because a lot of other teams are just sitting in the wheels doing nothing, and they will ride through the mountains like this in an armchair, and then in the mountains they will not even say thank you.
Oh, yeah? Yes?
The reward at the end of a long day of riding takes place here on the massage table with a soothing rub. A job performed only by men up until last year. 23-year-old April Wilburn is now one of three women trainers, or what is called a soigneur, for a professional cycling team. Part of her daily routine is to massage the aching bodies of the riders. And as you might well imagine, the question of a female trainer working with male athletes raises some eyebrows. But this is 1987, and the Tour has changed.
A body is just a body. It's not like you're lusting over these guys. You know, like my friends, they say, God, you're working around all these guys all the time. How can you handle it? But that's when you know you're an amateur and when you're a professional. You know, when you work professionally, it doesn't really faze you too much.
Here is the original female soigneur, American Shelley Versus.
Yeah?
She was the only woman on the Tour last year when she worked for 7-Eleven. Now she is the first woman working with a European team. Shelley knows well the difficulties of being the first woman in a man's sport in Europe.
I know. Well, with the 7-Eleven boys, they were all American. It was totally natural for me to work with them. I was like their sister. It was no big deal. Title IX, equal rights, a woman massaging a guy was no problem. But when I came to Toshiba, all these boys are foreign, except for Greg and Steve Bauer. They didn't speak English. All of a sudden, this chick comes along, American, to massage them. And they weren't sure whether to leave their underwear on, take it off. What was their wives going to say? It was a problem with the mechanics of my team, because usually the soigneur rooms with a mechanic. But the mechanic's wives didn't want me to room with them, so I have a single room all the time. That was kind of difficult, you know?
A day in the life of a soigneur begins at dawn, hours before the riders wake up. Preparing the food and drink for the riders takes some doing. Each day, a team consumes 20 gallons of drinks, 50 sandwiches, 20 packs of dried fruits, and 60 pounds of fresh fruit, all the while making sure each rider has his own special menu for his day on wheels. Then it's time to wake up the team, far better than any alarm clock I've ever seen. Because of the physical exertion involved, racing teams only once considered men capable of doing this job. First, the cooler goes in the trunk. And then a truckload of luggage. Remember, it's 9 riders on a team in a different hotel every night for 26 nights. And all this has to be done even before they get to the race start, where more work awaits, the little last-minute race preparations and the like. Other women in unlikely places on the Tour de France, and the number as well as the acceptance of women is growing each year. The riders seem to like it, and the race organizers are beginning to embrace the change. Only 4 years ago, women had to hide their hair under baseball caps to disguise themselves while riding in the caravan.
Not only there were no women, but they were forbidden. I mean, when a woman was seen in a car, it was a very strong misdemeanor. I mean, it was seen as a big breach of the rules. But now women are very important. As you see that we have a masseuse with the 7-Eleven team, and we'll see more and more of them. I think they are good sport, they are good fun, and they are good friends, and that's right.
The barriers for women are disappearing in the Tour de France, and this is only the beginning of a new era in a race set aside by its tradition. Of the tour, and the race today starts in a most unlikely spot, an equestrian arena in the town of Saumur, for this all-important race. Today's individual time trial is the first real test of this year's race. For a rider to even dream of winning the Tour de France, he has to do well here. Now, for the pure climbers, well, they'll be trying not to lose time before getting to their specialty next week in the Pyrenees and the Alps. For the other riders, they'll be trying to put distance between themselves and those who excel in the mountains. But one thing is abundantly clear here today. The standings will change, and the favorites for this year's Tour de France will step forward. One of those stars expected to emerge is Sean Kelly, the number one rider in the world, but he's not fully recovered from a recent illness. Andy Hampston is still being talked about as a possible tour winner, but he's never been on a 55-mile time trial before. The normally affable Stephen Roche knows today is serious business, but the importance of the time trial has even him edgy.
Have to wait and see you.
Feeling good?
If I get to the last 20 kilometers and I have nothing, like a lot of people will be today, it'll be all over. So I'll try to avoid a disaster and do a real good time.
The first of today's favorites, Sean Kelly, is in the start house and ready to go.
And Kelly, like everyone else who are pretenders to the title, now face the most important day so far. This is the longest time trial since 1951. The next 55 miles for Andy Hampston will be the most crucial of his career. Kelly is the first to leave among the fancied riders. While in the start house, Hampston fills up with air. He'll need plenty today.
Each rider starts after an interval between of 2 minutes. The last man overall goes first, and the leader of the race goes last. And behind Andy Hampson, Stephen Roach awaits the signal. Sean Kelly fights to find his rhythm. He already appears to be struggling. While Hampson, carrying all the American hopes for victory, quickly settles on his aerodynamic bike. These early miles tell a rider straight away how his body will react to the steady punishment of the race against the clock. But Stephen Roach is a time trial specialist. He is out to impress. This is his big chance. Kelly, his eyes fixed on the road ahead, concentrates hard, trying to shut out the pain of effort as he passes a slower rider who started 2 minutes in front. In the start house is Charlie Motte, France's hope now Bernard Hinault has retired. Hampson is really a climber, but he can only hope here to limit his losses to men like Roach. Roach hopes to play his first trump card, but the time trial demands so much from a confused body, and Roach is hoping today it will come right. He moves past a teammate, showing why he's the chosen leader of the team. Holding a constant speed of 28 miles per hour is the ability of only a few. One of those is Roach. Charlie Motte is also underway now. He too, like Roach, relishes the time trial. And 2 years ago, he won France's biggest, the Grand Prix de Nation. Kelly continues up ahead, still searching for comfort. He is not riding well on a hilly course that should have suited him. And Motte, racing through a corridor of noise, knows the cheers are all for him. His own lonely furrow, Hampson is losing 4 minutes to Roach, and that's not good. While for Kelly, it can't be over too soon. Hampson continues with the anxious glance at his watch, showing his concern. Roach is the giant of the time trial, and the time check showing to be ahead at all checkpoints. The longest time trial ever for Andy Hampson is almost over, and every second counts as he fights for the line. His time of 2 hours, 4 minutes and 31 seconds is not a great time for a top contender. Hampson's dug himself a hole he's going to literally have to climb out of in the mountains next week. But for the Irishman Stephen Roach, this was the moment of truth for him, and he hadn't told any lies. He'd excelled to his limit. His excellent time of 1 hour and 58 minutes and 11 seconds was the fastest time of the day. But at what cost to the Irishman? This had been the biggest effort ever for Stephen Roach in a time trial. With this time, Roach had climbed out of the anonymity of the field and up towards the leaders. But it had left its scars, and not just on Stephen Roach. The heat is getting worse and the race is getting harder, but today's been the hardest so far. Robert Miller, he performed far above his hopes. Now he waits for the mountain. But there are others who may never see them. For a long time. And what of Eric Mackler? He's worn the jersey for a week. Now it's gone. And Raul Alcala, forced to show that courage again after a serious crash that cut his eye and broke his finger. Paulie Motte had challenged Roche's time midway. And with a desperate sprint to the line, the Frenchman finished just 42 seconds slower. He's no longer a dark horse for final honours, but a real favourite now. Motte started the day a minute 36 seconds behind the yellow jersey of Eric Mackler. The Swiss finally succumbed to the race of truth. And after 6 days in yellow, Charlie Motte became the new man in the hot seat. So after stage 10, Motte is now the leader, and Roche is making his bid. Hampston still has a lot of work to do.
I'm pretty concerned, just because if I'm climbing really well, I'll be able to make up for it, but I don't like losing time in the first place, so it's not a good situation.
The race entered the beautiful chateau countryside of Limoges. And early on, as the field raced 159 miles from Poitiers to Charmey, a group of 10 escaped to pose more problems for the overall leaders. The ever-changing face of this race was again producing an unusual pattern. Group worked hard, building a lead of 9 minutes as the Limousin Hills began to wear down the field, tired from yesterday's time trial, that had put Charlie Motte in the leader's yellow jersey. But this was different now. Whereas Carrera chased everyone down this week, the System U team of Motte slowed the chase so that their team man up front, Marshall Gaillon, could gain time. It was to be another demonstration by System U of team strategy. Everybody watched Motte, so Gaillon took the initiative. The field were resigned to lose time, and the 7-11 team were also below par for the first time. Hampson drank at the back when perhaps he should have been at the front. And on this day, Jeff Bradley was being urged just to finish by teammate Ron Keeple. Raul Alcala also faced rehabilitation from Friday's crash in the time trial. Fortunes changed quickly in the Tour, but none quicker than for this man, Marshall Gaillon, who left the 10 leaders to win alone and take the overall lead away from his teammate, Charlie Motte. What a race this is turning out to be. But for some, it was all over. The opening 10 days has told on people like Bruno Wojcinek, a Frenchman who no longer will contest the sprint finishes he specializes in. His body cries enough, suffering from a back problem, and there's nothing you can do or say to help. And further ahead, Jeff Bradley and Bob Roll are also cast adrift, left to suffer in the desert conditions as they fall over half an hour behind. They suffer from sickness. What a difference a week makes in the Tour. The Tour de France is a heartless creature that provides every obstacle possible for man's success. In this hostile world, Bradley waits for Bob Roll, normally the strength of the 7-11 team. Now there's nothing to do but to go on. Bob Roll is ill, and there's no answer to that. Bob Roll was 7-11's highest finisher last year in the team's first Tour, and he carried Andy Hampson to victory in the Tour of Switzerland this year. Bob Roll, it really shouldn't have to be this way. Like a waiting vulture, the broom wagon is ready for the moment. No rider hopes for the run. Finally, Roll abandons the Tour de France. Bradley joins him. To both of them now, the pain is over, but the memories will remain. At the finish, it's a happy smiling face of Marshall Gaillon.
But for the 7-Eleven team, it's a moment of despair.
It's not really a bike race, though. It's a death march. Today's the first day of it.
And the march continues tomorrow into the Pyrenees, where the mountain passes hold the answers to the next chapter of a race with no obvious leader. What chances now for Andy Hampston? Now his team is down to 7.
I don't know, I hate to complain, but everything's coming apart.
Today's long stage through the vineyards of western France, over 145 miles from Brive-la-Gaillarde to Bordeaux, should have been a routine outing the day before the Pyrenees. Leading climber Raoul Alcala came up alongside Stephen Roach to keep an eye on him on behalf of Andy Hampston and his teammates. And a day two for Marshal Gaillon to show off his new yellow jersey. Further back in the pack, Sean Kelly, the Irishman who is a serious challenger for this year's tour, was showing the signs of injury after a fall during the first 45 miles. Kelly remounted in the race and he pedaled back to the bunch where he stayed for some 12 miles. But then the pain from an injured shoulder, which is being diagnosed this evening as torn ligaments, started to prove just too much. Kelly was a real favourite for this year's Tour de France, and he refuses to give in. But as the road started to climb, he could not grip the handlebars and the pain continued. Again, his team manager came alongside and asked him to stop. Sean Kelly's face says what everybody else was fearing. The damage to his shoulder is very, very serious indeed. Kelly is now 31. He's the world-ranked number one cyclist, and if he retired next year, he'd still be there because he's gained so many points in the world's top races. He's finished fourth and fifth in the Tour de France before, but his great ambition has been to win it. And here he's now stopped by the roadside. And Sean Kelly is forced to abandon the 1987 Tour de France. The first real casualty among the top contenders for victory.
You're right, Sean. You're right, boy. You're right, Sean. You'll be all right, Sean.
Meanwhile, up ahead in the race, Davis Finney was to become the first American to win a stage in this year's Tour de France. Avoiding the crash, Davis Finney won it in a sprint to the finish line in Bordeaux ahead of all rivals. And Davis Finney, a bright moment in an otherwise dismal week for the American team. So as you look at the list of Tour contenders, I'll remind you that we'll be in the Pyrenees to bring you all of the best racing from the Tour de France next Sunday. Until then, from Bordeaux, for Phil Liggett, I'm John Dockery.
America's Andy Hampston, this is the chance to seize control of a race that has already humbled some of the world's greatest athletes. Tropez, the jewel of the French Riviera, and the home of some of the most beautiful beaches in the world. And some of the most beautiful bodies in the world as well. At the heart of Saint-Tropez is the waterfront, once an important naval stronghold, now it plays host to all means of Mediterranean mariners. And today, this scenic seaside resort is our port of call here on CBS Sports Sunday.
Dockery, it was quite an experience waiting at the top for the first cyclist.
Some of the fans of French cyclista Charlie Moté saying he's going to win the Tour de France. We are 6,000 feet up on Montfaucon 2. They are going to have a time trial climbing up this mountain today. And John Dockery, watching them do this earlier in the week down at Luzardi, now was just absolutely unbelievable to me to see them make that climb and be hardly breathing heavily when they got to the top.
The thing that amazes me most as an athlete about this event is that the mental and physical toughness that's required to ride 2,500 miles. Think about that, 2,500 miles in 26 days across France. That's getting up day in and day out after struggling over mountaintops like this and being able to do it. It is just incredible to watch.
The spectacle is really awesome. To see the number of spectators lining the roads here, you can relate to a Super Bowl, perhaps 80, 100,000 people all packed in on one Sunday afternoon. This runs for a month and thousands more.
It's like a Super Bowl almost every day. There are 55 million people in France. About half of those folks will come out on the road to catch a glimpse, maybe 15 seconds of a rider flying by. And they come out, you know, hours in advance, some of them camping overnight. So it is really a traveling road show and a spectacle like none I've ever seen before.
They're talking about somewhere between 100 and 200,000 people lining the route here today. Well, from here, of course, they'll head into the Alps.
The Alps will really tell. We have four stages in the Alps before getting to the Champs-Élysées and the finish in Paris. And that's the place where the men worthy of wearing the yellow jersey will come forward.
Well, that's quite a spectacular view, is it not? And what a stage that was today up Mont Ventoux. It's a memorable experience for both me and for John Dockery to be there and see some of that. Today's stage was expected to be a turning point in this year's Wide Open Tour. John Dockery will be joined by Phil Liggett. They'll give you a full look at the excitement and intrigue of this third week of the Tour de France when Sports Sunday continues from France here on CBS.
To grab the Tour de France by the throat. It is time for America's Hope to take charge of a race searching for a Terminator. Hampston's first lieutenant, Raul Algaba, is now a threat to win himself. And Dog Otto Lawrenson has exploded onto the scene as 7-Eleven has taken the continent by storm. Irishman Stephen Roche is still the race favorite, but is the pressure eating away at his nerves? Yellow jersey, the rider with the best overall time, belongs to Charlie Moté of System U. But two-time Tour champion Laurent Fignon still leads the Tour's most dominant team. In the Pyrenees, the Tour de France turns from a bicycle race into a spectacle. A drama being played out before hundreds of thousands of spectators. Out of the shadows of these mountains, the upstart Colombians, led by Luis Herrera, have emerged as real contenders with the ability to dominate this race. The Pyrenees is the place to take the offensive.
I think people will be attacking. I think the Colombians will be pushing it. And I hope it explodes. But I hope I'm on the right exploding in.
Oh.
We at CBS Sports are proud to bring you the greatest bicycle race on earth. This is the Tour de France. Welcome to the stark beauty of Provence here in southern France, where today thousands are gathering for the most important race so far in this year's tour. Hello, everybody. I'm John Dockery. And later this afternoon, right here on Mont Ventoux, the 164 survivors in this year's tour will face the test they dread the most, an individual time trial over 20 miles up this mountain, all alone against the clock. And later today, we're going to bring you same-day coverage of this grueling race, almost certain to produce those riders worthy of wearing the yellow jersey 1 week from today in Paris. This year's Tour de France started in Berlin, the most distant start ever for a tour. After 2 days of racing through the streets of the divided city and another 2 days in Germany, the tour came home, crossing the border into France at Strasbourg. From Strasbourg, the riders headed west across Champagne country, where scorching heat was a common enemy. But for tour favorite Stephen Roche, his problem was not just the heat. It was also his team working hard in sizzling temperatures to protect the yellow jersey worn by Eric Macklin. After all, weren't they supposed to be working for Roche? The big surprise of the early going was Mexican cyclist Raul Alcala. Riding for the American team, he would be a valuable ally in Andy Hampson's bid for the yellow jersey. The tour then headed south, where Andy Hampson would face his first real test, an individual time trial. It was a disappointment, but still Hampson remained in contention. But he was no match for Irishman Stephen Roche, who solidified his status as the man to beat in this year's tour. 7-Eleven's Dag Otto Lorenzen was a surprise, placing much higher than expected, giving the American team another weapon in their growing arsenal. But when it was over, system used Charlie Mote, with a second-place finish in a time trial, wore the yellow jersey because he had the best overall time thus far. Then it's south into wine country, where System U maintained control of the pack. Team leader Laurent Fignon had taken on a new role, the protector's role, on a team so dominant that it could put even a domestique like Marshall Guyant in the yellow jersey, if only for a day. In Bordeaux, the tour picked up speed, and a mad dash to the finish resulted in a serious crash. But out of the chaos came 7-Eleven's Davis Finney, with the only stage victory by an American to date, matching the one he earned last year. After Bordeaux, the riders see their first real mountains, first to the Pyrenees to test their mettle, and across the scorching plains of Provence. And then on into the Alps, where the men who would be champions separate themselves from those who simply ride bicycles for a living. From there, it's north to Paris and the finish, where the survivors will have completed their 2,524-mile journey in 26 days. And of the 207 riders who started in Berlin, a little more than half will see the finish in Paris, before hundreds of thousands of cheering fans. And the final sprint down the Champs-Élysées serves as an escort for the man in the yellow jersey, the man who has beaten them all in their wild journey across France. And the question this year is, who will be the successor to last year's champion, Greg LeMond? The reconstructed 7-Eleven team can now boast three serious contenders capable of mounting the winner's platform in Paris. It's no longer just team leader Andy Hampson. It could also be Raul Alcala, the climber from Mexico. The talk around this year's tour is the growth of 7-Eleven. One expert told me earlier this week that 7-Eleven is now one of the top seven cycling teams in the world, a quantum leap for the Americans.
Up on the top, and it rolls along, goes down a little.
The two Colombian teams, each with some of the best climbers in the world, hope to keep their singing going when the tour reaches the peaks of the Pyrenees and the Alps.
Hello,
But Stephen Roche still remains the most watched racer in this year's tour. The Pyrenees are next.
For the last 1,200 miles of the Tour de France, the people have lined the route expecting to see an obvious leader of the race, and it hasn't happened. You know, as we enter the Pyrenees, there are still at least 10 riders who can win this Tour de France. That hasn't happened perhaps in 40 years. You've always had an Eddy Merckx or a Bernard Hinault, or indeed last year's winner Greg LeMond, as obvious chiefs of the pack. Well, the Pyrenees normally are great levellers, but the way this Tour de France is going, it really could only add to the confusion of a very mysterious tour.
It's Bastille Day in the Basque capital of Po, gateway to the Pyrenees. Two major climbs to the mountaintop finish at Luz-Ariden, a critical test for those expecting to win this year's Tour de France.
A lot of people are scared. I'm going to follow everything today and see what happens, and then at the end, really open up.
And he's going very good also. I think he's just waiting for the moment to come.
You know, there's no excuses today where it's going to happen.
Out of Po, it was clear what was in the minds of those who felt that they had a chance to win this year's Tour de France. This race without a dominant leader has given many the hope that this could be their year. The mountains should confirm or destroy those hopes. Gateway to the Pyrenees, which borders France with Spain, and the route last Tuesday weaved an evil thread as it climbed to the summit of the 5,600 feet obese mountain. From there it descended until the much feared Singing the Tail lifted the riders right back up to the same height and the finish at the ski station of Luz-Ariden. But before both those climbs could be reached, the field had an hors d'oeuvre in the form of the Col de Marie Blanc, a baby at a mere 3,400 feet. Davis Finney, winner of Bordeaux last Sunday, was soon attacking, hoping to make gains before the mountains began. While behind, the two Colombians, Wilches and Herrera, were being shadowed by Andy Hampson, who feared them. The slopes of Marie Blanc are not high, but they sure are steep for Davis Finney. While at the
the top two early escapers were leading them all. Tightly bunched together, packed, all the favorites continued their nervous game of man marking man.
Finney continued to tire, but still made it across the top of Marie Blanche, the first major climb, with two more still to come. Finney led the pack by about a minute, and on his descent pursued the leaders. Behind, the main pack stayed together, with the stars keeping an eye on one another. Here, some of the riders took time to place a newspaper under their shirts to prevent sweat from turning to ice on their way down the mountain. The climb up Marie Blanche had not proved decisive.
Watching each other instead of attacking, Dag Otto Lauritsen takes his chance to try and recoup time lost the previous day, and he breaks clear to launch a 50 miles an hour pursuit of the men ahead. For the main field, the cold mist on the Marie Blanche at least forced them to keep warm on the descent, but as of yet there was no real interest in Lauritsen, Finney and the two Frenchmen up front. For Dag Otto Lauritsen, here was a chance to recover at least some of the 15 minutes he lost in the opening day in the Pyrenees, which dropped him from 5th to 20th overall. That is why men like Laurent Fignon, twice the winner of the Tour, and his group of race favourites, including Andy Hampstead, are not yet concerned by a man a long way behind on time. Instead, they are more content to watch each other's every move. Finney, tiring fast, has been caught by a few riders, and at the back, Lauritsen's inspired chase brings him towards the leaders on the road. And dancing onto the lower slopes of the obese mountain, Andy Hampstead controls the main group of riders, who still are unconcerned by the Lauritsen attack. After all, this climb goes on for 10 miles. But ahead, unfashionable Frenchman Thierry Claverolla, who seeks only a single day's glory and who broke away at the start of the day with David Finney, was now ahead alone, trying to be the first over the obese. But behind, the Norwegian member of the American 7-Eleven team was building his confidence in a small group, and he looked good. David Finney had lost his confidence and was gone. Who'll be first over the obese? We'll find out when we return. Hello! It was Thierry Claverolla, a man who has no chance of winning the Tour de France, who crosses the top of the Col d'Orbiche mountain first, to a great ovation from the French public. And chasing him up the climb was Dutchman Teun van Vliet, a man from the lowlands finding his wings in the Pyrenees. The Dutchman was excelling, and it was hurting as he chased Claverolla. Lauritsen had been caught by all of the race favourites, including Andy Hampstead and Stephen Roche. And at the back, the yellow jersey can be seen of Charlie Motte. Ahead, Van Vliet has joined Claverolla. Now there are two in front. The leaders have crossed the summit, and the chase is on at 60 miles an hour. Descend from the misty heights of the obese, and very shortly they'll face the climb up towards the finish at Loup's Ardidens. But But having used his skill on descent once before, Doug Otto-Lauritsen moves ahead again with Cody Claverola, his next target. Lauritsen, riding with grim determination, catches the tiring Frenchman and then begins to concentrate on catching the Dutchman, Toon van Vliet, who is out front alone. Lauritsen, an Olympic bronze medalist in Los Angeles in 1984, was now on an inspired performance again. Suffering like never before, van Vliet was trying to lead all the way to the mountain at Les Ardennes. It was his big chance to escape the favourites. But the chase behind by Lauritsen was merciless as he stoked up for the long pursuit in no man's land. He was behind the hound, but in front of the pack. Otto Lauritsen has raced only for 6 years, and the 27-year-old ex-Norwegian policeman only turned to cycling after an accident while parachuting almost left him a permanent cripple. Lauritsen's leg broke in mid-air when his parachute opened badly. Doctors said he would have a permanently stiff leg. They should see him now. Toon van Vliet was needing all the help he could get on the final climb towards the finish because the Norwegian was in determined mood. Until this year, Dag has raced only on European teams, but he was hired by 7-Eleven to help Andy Hampson win the Tour. He says he's at home with the Americans. Behind them both, there was a stirring among the favourites on the last climb. Andy Hampson seemed ready for the challenge to come. But was Robert Miller, Scotland, who has won twice before in the Pyrenees, in years gone by. He was anxious to prove he was a contender for the whole Tour. A rider for only 6 years, Lauritsen can hardly boast a wealth of experience. Yet, on the toughest day in the Pyrenees, he continues to chase his quarry down. This was only his second Tour de France. It was certainly going to be his best. After 4 miles of the 10 miles climb towards the ski station, Lauritsen picks up an exhausted van Vliet. And even though there are 6 miles to go, Lauritsen doesn't give van Vliet any time to recover. And further behind, Andy Hampson is trying to apply the pressure, but the anticipated battle is not materializing. Herrera rides alongside him. And just behind him, Robert Miller is content to follow. The others are here too, Pablo Wilches and Stephen Roach from Ireland. No one, it seems, willing to attack the Pyrenees. One man is though, and to enormous cheers, the first mountaintop finish in this year's Tour de France was about to bring about the first ever Norwegian stage winner. Even the weather was ripe for the man from Scandinavia. It was cold, windy and wet. And Lauritsen knew by now, too, that he was being chased by Colombia's Lucio Herrera, who had reduced a minute deficit to just a few seconds in the last mile. The Norwegian was being forced to produce a grandstand finish. A near cripple who had proved what is possible if you never lose faith. Lauritsen succeeded in his stage win, but what's the picture? Herrera wasn't far behind. And it was turning out to be a great day for the 7-Eleven team. Andy Hampson had slipped the group and gained almost a minute over his most dangerous men. And not only that, but another teammate was now in the top 12 to add strength to the strategy later. Hampson finishes in third place. He's gained time on the men he feared most.
So after 14 stages, Charlie Moté keeps the yellow jersey, Jean-Francois Bernard is second, Stephen Roach sits a close third. But the real surprise is the upstart 7-Eleven team with three riders in the top dozen. Lauritsen and Alcala now provide a diversion to those waiting for Andy Hampson to make his move. But no one is more impatient than Hampson himself.
You know, I've been riding, kind of following other people and letting them dictate the pace. And I'm way down, so it's time for me to dictate the pace, even though it's more energy and it helps other riders. You know, I've got to start riding my race.
We are working for Andy because he is the captain. But my goal in this tour was to win a stage, and I've done it now, so I'm very happy.
From the mist and the mountains, the Tour de France now goes to the floods of the flatlands.
Beginning. But for me, in an hour's time, I'll be in the backseat of a car traveling at 60 miles an hour in luxurious circumstances. But for the riders, for them, they'll be back in the saddle for yet another very hard day. You know, life's not all sweat, blood and tears in the Tour de France. The sun is shining, it's a nice day in prospect. There's a general feeling of ambience in the Tour de France. Every day the pack rolls out of town, the colourful cavalcade is ready to give another day of entertainment. Time to lap off the wounds of the race so far. Doesn't the yellow jersey know it's illegal to give interviews on the move? Time for a change? Strange place to keep your shirt. And this is not the time to try on a new pair of shoes, surely. Well, breakfast was a bit rushed this morning. A tablet might help. And if you live on the route, why not stop and say hi? And if you can't go home, send a message. If you're a real star, then the whole town turns out. Remember the motto, don't drink and drive. You might spill it. The whistle is not for the race, just the guests. Brothers Pascal and Jerome Simon arrive, sent ahead with the blessing of the race. For these French stars, it's a major happening. Oh yes, it really is quite fun riding the Tour de France. After all, nobody ever really races in the morning. Professionals in the Tour, these are ways of releasing tension, but there's a serious side too. In France, ditches are everywhere, and riders seem to find most of them. After breaking it, you've got to fix it, but on the move. There's no time to stop. Everything else fails, a new bike is the only answer. Lunch is taken at a snack, and if you miss, you'll be hungry later. There's no time for French etiquette either, just get it down. The water carriers of the Tour build up a reservoir of supplies. If you run out of pockets, there's always room for the bottle down your back or behind your ear. Remember, what goes in? It's enough to make the sunflowers blush, but not enough to stop them watching the Tour pass by. But no one should forget, the Tour de France is a race, and when the weather changes to its worst, the race just goes on, even though the crowds can seek the comfort of a shelter. After two sunny weeks, the Tour de France has run into its worst weather for many, many years. The leaders cannot afford to make mistakes. In these conditions, anything can happen, as the torrential rain makes the roads treacherous and the riders more conscious of survival. still a race, or were we now at sea? When the road has disappeared between 12 inches of water, one wishes they could walk on it. But near the end, the System U team attack, but they should be careful not to maroon their leader in yellow. But whatever the dramas are during a day in the Tour de France, one thing is certain, the finish line will not come soon enough for many of the riders who make the Tour de France something quite, quite special.
Every athlete enters a competition with the knowledge that there could be a surprise ending. But each hopes that he has the ability to write that ending in his own way. For 7-Eleven's Davis Finney, the end came 1 week earlier than planned. In Saturday's early morning hours, Finney packed his gear before heading home to Boulder, Colorado. Thursday was his last day of racing.
I've never, ever, ever felt that bad in a bike race in my whole life.
Finney, the first 7-Eleven stage winner ever, and again the first this year, was a motivational leader of this team and really just wanted to finish the Tour de France.
You know, this race is very, very unforgiving, and I picked up a virus, and 36 hours without food, I struggled through one race, and, I don't know, 130 miles, and it was probably one of the worst days of my life, and I thought that maybe I could get over it, but it was just one day too many to the rest day, and yesterday I couldn't even get out of bed.
Finney's departure followed those of Bob Roll and Jeff Bradley, and is the most serious blow yet to a team that had been gathering momentum throughout the race. But for the second year in a row, Davis Finney must kiss off his chance of finishing the Tour de France. But the final stories of this year's Tour de France have yet to be told, and the ominous face of Mont Ventoux, where today the fate of the Tour might be decided, also brings back memories of a tragic Tour 2 decades ago. Here's Phil Liggett.
20 years ago, the Tour de France wrote one of its saddest chapters of its history. The great British cyclist, Tommy Simpson, died here on Mont Ventoux in the heat of Provence summer. It's a barren mountain. Normally it's covered in snow throughout 7 months of the year. But at this particular time when Tommy died, there was a reflected heat of 150 degrees. Simpson was a kilometre from the top of the mountain when he was seen to zigzag across the road. Then, as he fell off his bike, the helpers came up and he said, "Put me back on my bike," and they did so. Within yards, Simpson fell again, and this time he died. Tommy Simpson was the greatest British cyclist ever. He's still the only British rider ever to have worn that leader's yellow jersey. The Tour de France will remember him forever. This year, Mont Ventoux is back in the race for the first time since 1974 for a time trial. It'll be a crucial part of the Tour, and it should write another chapter of this amazing race's history. And this is Mont Ventoux today, the inhospitable mountain waiting for the early arrivals in today's 23 miles time trial that is certain to provide a major turning point of the Tour. Stay with us. We'll be back.
Hello.
Dawn came over the flatlands of Provence in southern France today, and in the distance, the mountain that is to play a crucial part in this year's Tour de France. Skate surface of the 6,200 feet climb of Mont Ventoux. At the top, everything is ready for the torture chamber of the Tour de France this day.
Hey,
In the start house, the American rider Andy Hampston. He comes here seventh overall in the Tour de France. He must excel this day if he is to go into the final week a contender for victory.
Five, four, three, two, and stop.
So Andy Hampston has made his bid, starting in the town of Carpentras. He now faces 23 miles of sheer purgatory. A time trial, man against the watch, man against himself. Luis Carrera, 7 minutes 50 seconds behind the leader today. Andy Hampston already up the road, starting 3 minutes ahead of him. But the great little climber, Luis Carrera of Colombia, he's claimed back 7 minutes in this last week of the Tour de France. Now he's on his favourite road. Alcala, another man who's shown so well in the mountains, waits for his start. Out in Carpentras now, on the way towards Mont Ventoux, Hampston makes his progress. While behind, it's Luis Carrera who chases him. Inch by inch, he closes in. Back in the start house, Stephen Roche, third overall this morning, thinking of the yellow jersey. Already beginning to show signs of faltering today, Hampston begins to suffer. And the same applies to Raul Alcala, the little Mexican. France's hope lies with Jean-Francois Bernard, second from last to start today, in the heat of the day down in Carpentras. He dreams too of yellow. Stephen Roche, already up the road ahead of him, begins the lower slopes of Mont Ventoux. And there, Mont Ventoux awaits its barren countryside, looking down on the valley below, where this drama is now being enacted. And Andy Hampston is showing the pain of carrying the pressures of trying to win the Tour de France for the United States. Little Colombian climber Lucho Herrera gets into his rhythm well today. He's shown it in the Pyrenees. He's now shown he has tremendous form. He inches closer and closer to Andy Hampston. Hampston visibly riding slower now. He's broken clear of the tree line of the climb. Lower down, but not much further behind, is Herrera. And then Herrera has Hampston in his sight. And the gap is closed shut. 3 minutes made by Luis Herrera at a most crucial stage of the Tour. And Raul Alcala too, set to lose now 9 minutes this day, and his Tour de France for victory is over. The moment of truth for Andy Hampston. He's coursed and passed. He looks across at Lucho Herrera. What must he feel like now as he falls 3 minutes behind on time? For the Dublin rider, Stephen Roche, there's still plenty of hope. He's riding within himself on the barren slopes of Mont Ventoux in the heat of mid-afternoon sun. But for Andy Hampston now, climbing towards the summit, over 3 minutes lost to Herrera, he must ask himself now if his Tour de France is over. Herrera reaches the top of the mountain, and his time, 1 hour 21 minutes 23 seconds, is the best so far. Lower down, Hampston even has to give way to the team cars. But through the corridor of crowd now, the crowd cheers Stephen Roche. He's married to a French girl, and they cheer him all the way up. But there are no such cheers for Andy Hampston. His time is 4.5 minutes slower than Herrera's.
Coming up the mountain, Jean-Francois Bernard, near the back to start, was the best time through all the checkpoints. All of France were cheering now, a man who could take yellow. At the summit of the climb, Stephen Rhodes finishes with the excellent time of 1 hour, 22 minutes and 3 seconds. He's still in contention. And the last few yards now for Jean-Francois Bernard, the man they used to compare with Bernard Hinault, and he said they were all too soon. He wasn't ready yet. So Bernard came up to the finishing line here on Mont Ventoux at 4 o'clock this afternoon to win the 18th stage of the Tour de France and take the overall lead. But for Andy Hampson of America, he sat in his car and reflected on what might have been, because this day he seems to have lost the Tour de France. And after 5 days in the yellow jersey, Charlie Mottet finishes ninth this day and loses his yellow jersey to Jean-Francois Bernard. And so the standings tonight on this special day in the Tour de France. Bernard leads with a winning time of 1:19.44, and the overall lead also passes to Bernard. Roche now in second place, Mottet falls to third. And of the rest, Hampson goes back to ninth and Raul Alcala down to 11th. And so with a week to go, the Tour de France has its new leader, Jean-Francois Bernard. From the top of Mont Ventoux, it's goodbye.
Hello, everybody. I'm Tim Ryan, and welcome to this final edition of CBS Sports Sunday telecast from France. Well, it is literally a party here in Paris today, a victory parade for the leader and a salute to the survivors. And we'll celebrate with all of France, and we'll bring you the tense battles of the past week for the right to wear the yellow jersey today. And later on CBS Sports, a dramatic change of venue, Talladega, Alabama, where Dale Earnhardt will try to widen his NASCAR points lead in the 500. And a touch of France from the Midwest, Grand Blanc, Michigan, for the final round of the Buick Open. But first, the Tour de France. And over the 26 torturous days that have led here to Paris, perhaps the most significant was last Sunday, an individual time trial, one man against the clock, uphill. The French call it the race of truth.
It's only a mountain, one of many you can see on this French country morning. But for 171 young men, it would be a place where they would dare to ask themselves the questions of greatness. This mountain where 171 came willing to pay perhaps the final price for their quest. Of the Tour de France was chiseled into these walls of rock by men willing to ask more of themselves, knowing that this time for some, the answers from their bodies would be no more. For Andy Hampson, a 25 years old from North Dakota, the day began with hopes of a climb to victory. Instead, with each push of his legs, each gasp for more air, the answer would come back, no, this would not be his year. The yellow jersey was the destiny of another. He would not be alone. Have long since been answered. Pedro Delgado's
quest for glory had been answered so cruelly in the past by close finishes and personal tragedy. Yet today, she would dare to answer again when the mountain repeated its relentless challenge. How high, how far, how fast. Jean-François Bernard would face his fate, carrying the heaviest load of all, the thirst of a nation longing for a hero. Not just any hero, but one who would fit the classic mold of the great Bernard Hinault.
CBS Sports are proud and happy to bring you the greatest bicycle race on earth. Welcome to the Tour de France. Paris, the city every rider in the Tour de France dreams of. Hello, everybody. I'm John Dockery. And over one-third of those riders who began in Berlin almost a month ago will not see the finish here today. For the survivors, this has been one of the more brutal tours in history. And Phil Liggett, this past week in the Alps, bizarre and torturous.
John, this has been the most viciously competitive race I think I can recall. And you know why? Because in West Berlin, 12 riders really felt they could win this Tour de France. And now in the Alps, we're down to three. Jean-François Bernard of France, Stephen Roche of Ireland, and Pedro Delgado of Spain. From those three, John, one will be the winner of this tour.
And Phil, we're going to take a look at their struggle in the mountains right after this. As the riders prepared for the tough week ahead in the Alps, Jean-François Bernard fancied himself in his newly acquired yellow jersey. Stephen Roche had some trouble with his fit. He was wearing a special jersey, usually reserved for the tour's second-place man. Perhaps a swap with Bernard could be arranged. Pedro Delgado was still in his team colors, but talked about changing to yellow with an attack in the
mountains.
Lucho Herrera, the sleeper in this year's tour, dreamt of a colored jersey all his own.
Moi, je trouve que le jaune, ça me va pas mal.
But now is the time that now if we see we had that he's on a bad day, or we can leave him behind a little. Nobody waits now.
And so with the thought that nobody waits from now on, the survivors of this vicious race leave Valréas and head 160 miles into the Alps and Villard de Lans. Hadn't been hard enough already. From now on, it was going to be inside the very heart of Dante's Inferno. The men who have suggested a victory for over 2 weeks now have to prove their quality, and soon the pressure goes on to break the spirit of the rest. Pedro Delgado is almost 4 minutes behind Jean-François Bernard, and he soon joined in the attack with Stephen Roche to gain time. And the man missing from this group of escapers is the yellow jersey himself of new leader Bernard. The Frenchman's first day in yellow was turning out to be a nightmare. Attacked from all sides, his recovery was being hampered by a flat tire, and the leaders ahead were offering no quarter. This was a chance to eliminate another challenger from an ever-changing race pattern. Bernard was launched back into the race, but in just a few hours, he's found the lonely world of being a leader. Of the top five in the race, only Bernard was missing, and as the hill steepened, Delgado launches his attack.
and Roche is the only one to react to the Spaniard's expected move. You never let a climber go too far away, and Roche didn't. Behind, Bernard is already out of his yellow jersey. The Lombard 2 is a dream now. At the finish, Delgado and Roche are still together. But while Delgado sprints clear for the stage victory, Roche, who started the day in second place with a better overall time than Delgado, will be only the third Irishman in history to lead the Tour de France. On this first day in the Alps, two riders have projected themselves as the strongmen of the Tour. Are the mountains ready to reveal their secrets? So Roche is in yellow now, the first Irishman since Sean Kelly in 1983.
As you look at the standings, Roche is the leader, but Delgado and Bernard are very close behind. Andy Hampston is out of contention. And on the next morning, before the trip to Alpe d'Huez, Roche didn't let his colors change his personality. Perhaps taking a cue from his affable adversary, Pedro Delgado also found time for some easygoing fun. And as the riders started on their 126-mile journey through the Alps, ending at the second highest finish in this year's race, they had to be thinking of one of the Tour's great obstacles, the final climb to Alpe d'Huez. Today's stage would indeed be a showdown. But at least one rider had something else on his mind. 1 year ago, on this very same road, in this very same stage, Pedro Delgado, in the same position of strong contender, abandoned the Tour. He had learned the night before of his mother's death and decided to continue his quest for the yellow. But during the race, Delgado was overcome with the reality of the news and could not go on. But this year, Pedro Delgado, with eyes on Stephen Roche's yellow jersey, will finish his trip to Alpe d'Huez and dedicate it to his mother.
A long time in a professional rider's career. They say you only have 8 of them. Now Pedro Delgado was inspired. He was riding with one thought, to dedicate a race victory to the memory of his mother. He's recognized Stephen Roche as his only challenger, and the only place to beat him is in the mountains. On the day's last climb of Alpe d'Huez, he was on the attack. Roche was left on the 6,100-feet climb, which has 22 switchbacks to lift it to its summit. Delgado is now putting him under pressure, the same pressure that cost Bernard his lead the day before. Riding like a demon, Delgado had to finish 79 seconds in front of Roche. With no help from the followers, Roche was carrying the full weight of a Tour that still could find no solid leader. But one thing was certain, the ladder to Alpe d'Huez was eliminating everyone else in the victory in Paris. The now familiar corridor of noise, Delgado nears the summit, still searching for the seconds that will give him a yellow jersey on the anniversary of the death of his mother. Roche has no answer to a man driven by such emotion. The Irishman can only hope he lives to fight another day. On the cruelest of mountains, Delgado doesn't slow down, while ironically, Roche has to follow behind Bernard, the man he destroyed the previous day. On top of the mountain, Delgado feels on top of the world. This was for his mother. Yes, this really was Pedro Delgado's day. He was the new yellow jersey for the first time in his career. And while he remembers his mother, his sister was having her first child. Could he be the first Spanish winner since 1973? If he anticipates final victory in Paris, he'll have to continue to attack in the mountains to come. And the next day will be the most difficult here in the Alps.
For Roche, he's dropped to second place in this seesaw race. He can't lose any more time if he holds any hope of final victory. After 1,400 miles in 21 days, the Tour has left its scars. So Delgado leads and Roche hovers at 25 seconds behind. The rest are now out of contention. We're down to the two who can win. But there are more surprises in a race where the riders always change the script. We'll be back.
On what promises to be the most grueling day of this most grueling race, Stephen Roche remains as approachable as ever.
Good morning. How are you?
This is a man who will talk to anyone and sign anything. French oak Jean-Francois Bernard, a national hero in yellow just 3 days ago, stands alone while all the attention is focused on Roche, the people's choice in this year's Tour. Colombian Lucho Herrera is finally within striking distance of the lead, but also finds himself alone to ponder his fate. Hey, is this man running for office? Does he want to be president of France? And wait, isn't this the yellow jersey? Is Pedro Delgado embarrassed to wear his colors in public? Today, the Tour leaves the peaceful village of Bordeaux-Saint on a trip over three difficult climbs.
The 146 survivors of a remarkable Tour de France rolled out of the Alpine village of Bourg-Bazon, not knowing what the day held in store for them. Many just wanted to finish, but two wanted to win. As pointed as a row of shark's teeth, this day in the Alps was as ferocious, with the crossing of the 8,000 feet Col de Galibier. The 116-mile stage zigzagged across to the Col de la Madeleine, before finally coming to rest at the top of the punishing climb to the ski station at La Plaine. It was to be a day of pain and surprise. The field were soon climbing the Col de Galibier, the highest peak of the race, with the front group already reduced to the familiar names of this great race. Roche second and searching for just 25 seconds to win back the yellow jersey from Delgado, while the Spaniard himself, now pedaling on his beloved mountain terrain, has other ideas as the field climbs the highest peak. Out of contention are men like two-times winner Laurent Fignon, 15 minutes behind. The Colombian climber Lucho Herrera over 5 minutes back. This battle now is between two men, Ireland's Stephen Roche and Spain's Pedro Delgado. So were the mountains going to be at last the turning point of a Tour that has had 8 different leaders already? Who would be elevated into that final yellow jersey in Paris on Sunday? To almost inaccessible places to watch for the answer. But it wouldn't come on the Col de Galibier, where the leaders climbed over the top together. On the rapid descent from the last of the winter snow, the race again produced its ups and downs. This race, it requires concentration. One slip, not only would the race be lost, but you could be in hospital.
mountains on this side of the valley always miss the strong sun, so the snows of 7 months give again a moonscape appearance. The dangers are real, and Molenfignon overshoots a corner, and only bushes save a long fall to the valley below. But who's going to collect the bike? There's no cooler customer than Fignon, but he was lucky.
But some who crashed weren't as lucky as Laurent Fignon. After 22 days and 2,000 miles of high-pressure racing, exhaustion can lead to a small mistake, and the smallest mistake can lead to disaster. Such was the case with Erwin Niebauer. The Dutch rider crashed on the day's first climb and was forced out of the race, taken to the hospital by helicopter. His small mistake in a dark mountain tunnel ended his chance of finishing the race. The Tour de France is not always about the yellow jersey.
In the valley, but before the climb of the 6,500 feet Col de la Madeleine, Roche was in attacking mood. He was thinking of taking back his 25 seconds needed for the yellow jersey. No one would expect an attack on the flat this day. Further back, Delgado was more interested in taking on food for the climbs to come. This was a move no one expected with 60 miles to go. Roche was either mad or very confident. Behind the important actors in this play clearly thought he was mad. And to a man, they fueled up for the chase. With a small group of willing men out for the day's spoils, Roche fought to push home the shock attack of the race. We were heading for the start of the Col de la Madeleine. Roche had a lead of 1 minute 36 seconds over Delgado. That made him the new race leader on the road. Roche had slipped the man who he feared most in the mountains. He knew he couldn't do it on the climb, so why not do it on the flat in between, and then try and hang on as the Madeleine started. The field behind, as always, was making the yellow jersey chase his nearest rival. Roche continued in fine rhythm, but clearly worried by progress as he glances down the mountain. Wolf in sheep's clothing? Further up the mountain, it was a good time to protest about the price of lamb this year. The police cleared the road just in time. The steep slopes of the 12 miles climb personified on Roach's face. Behind, Delgado was warming to the occasion as the hill got tougher. Below was Delgado's group, and above him was the group of Roche. They could see each other. Over the top of the climb, Roche was still clear with a long descent to come before the last mountain to the finish. While Delgado and his select group of chasers were still coming up, but continuing to narrow the gap. Was anxious to keep his advantage, and with no small risk involved, he led the way down the mountain. At the summit, Herrera is next over, but the group is concerned, and Delgado also looks worried. But the gradient had told, and Roche is pegged back to 48 seconds with 43 miles to go. With the last 10-mile climb to come, Roche seemed to be committing suicide. His gamble was failing. Would advantage soon be Delgado? With the tall strongmen still around him, Delgado has the help he needs. But the unexpected chase is a sobering thought. But after a chase of almost 30 miles, the strong men have the fugitives in their sights as they work their way through the second feeding station of the day. Roche had gambled on slipping Delgado on the flat,
but it was a gamble that failed, and he stays in second place overall as the leaders regroup. So to the last battlefield this day, the drunken slopes of La Plan, back up to nearly 6,500 feet, and where the drama of this tour reaches a crescendo. Of men who refuse to succumb to their slopes. And with the stage ready for the last battle of La Plan, Lucho Herrera was having his own problems just staying on his bike. The leaders pass him by as he will begin to move off. Roche was now back among them, his brave attack a failure. He now had to ask himself if he had the energy for this last climb. Jean-Francois Bernard too, perhaps thinking of improving his third place in this race. But while the leaders were planning their hope for victory in Paris, Laurent Fignon planned on winning at La Plagne, and the man who very nearly saw his day end in tragedy sprints ahead. His 15-minute deficit overall brings only a token resistance from the rest. He's caught only by Anselmo Fuerte, a Spanish climber. And together, they plan to leave the tactical battle raging behind. This is only the second time the Tour de France has visited the ski station. We'll remember it for a long time after this day. Pedro Delgado is a climbing specialist, and if he's to win this race, he must continue to improve his time advantage over Stephen Roche. Here we have the strange situation where the yellow jersey must attack, even though he's already in front. Delgado had attacked as soon as the climb began, and Roche at the back here was now on the defensive after a day of promise. He must be asking himself about the wiseness of his move. Delgado was not interested in Fignon and Fuerte ahead, just in getting as far in front of Roche as he possibly could. He needed as much time as possible before this race left the mountains. He knew that if he didn't get it, the advantage would pass to Roche in the last time trial at Dijon. It looked good for Delgado as Roche suffered the pain that only this race can inflict. Even the Colombian climber Lucho Herrera was suffering on the road he too usually loves best. Delgado was out to win the race here, and now he was at last playing all the cards he had been dealt. Was it a winning hand? With 6 miles to go, he led Roche by 50 seconds. The Irishman has to show not just the ability that made him a favourite, but the courage of the sort that makes some men greater than others. The Tour de France had become a duel between the Spanish leader, urged on by the memory of his mother, and an Irishman trying to become a legend in his own lifetime. Delgado needed, in his own words, at least 2 minutes lead over Roche, and time was running out. Just like on top of Alpe d'Huez the day before, Delgado was gaining time on Roche. The Tour at last seemed to have found its true owner of the Golden Fleece. At the finish, and almost forgotten about in the race behind, Laurent Fignon was winning the stage from Fuerte. Some compensation for the former Tour winner, who was too far back this time to challenge either Delgado or Roche overall. Towards the end, Delgado was still ahead, but his arched back indicated he was struggling to complete the climb. There were anxious glances behind, and although it seemed impossible, Stephen Roche was unbelievably fighting back from a lost cause. Delgado headed up towards the ski station. His near-minute lead had evaporated in only the final 2 kilometres. Roche was not far behind, as from somewhere he found fresh power. And as Delgado crosses the line, his quest for minutes had become seconds, for the brilliant Irishman was only just behind him. This was a sign of a true champion, and a fight back the Tour had rarely seen. Roche arrived at the Col Summit completely exhausted after an extraordinary effort that was necessary to stay in this race to Paris. While Roche suffered, Delgado looked amazingly fresh. He can only recall a lost chance. Stephen Roche, 5 miles from the end this day, had all but lost the Tour de France. He knew he needed a special effort. The Tour de France itself is special. Roche produced what was required, but at what cost? This had been a battle between two great athletes, and as yet, there was still no obvious winner. The question now was, could Rhodes come off the ground to fight back, or was this the end for the courageous Irishman who was suffering from an oxygen death?
On this devastating day of racing, Pedro Delgado kept the yellow jersey. The struggle to get it on, perhaps an omen of the struggle ahead to try to keep it. As a result of his superhuman charge to the finish, Stephen Roche left the mountain wrapped in a thermal blanket. Roche's hospital stay was brief, but the questions lingered. Would he be able to come back with enough strength to mount a challenge to regain the yellow jersey? Or had Roche given too much of himself to the mountains? Trailed Delgado by 39 seconds with 4 days of racing left. Moté and Bernard chased the leaders. As for the American team, none were in contention. Alco was tops in the standings, while an ailing Andy Hampston was far behind. The next morning, Stephen Roche, his oxygen debt repaid, was back smiling and talking.
Good morning. Good morning, Stephen. How are you
doing this morning? Like new. Like new.
No problem from yesterday, eh?
Just sore legs, but that's normal, I think.
Will today be okay for you, or do you think you'll have an edge on?
No, I think I'm a strong boy, yeah.
There you go.
2 days later, Pedro Delgado was fighting both real and imaginary bulls. Roche had come back and trailed by only 21 seconds. The pair were ready for the final confrontation, a time trial in Dijon. We'll be back. Had come down to this, a single race to decide a champion, the race of truth. One man against the clock, two men against each other. If you're 28-year-old Stephen Roche, how do you spend the hours before the moment you pointed to your whole life? If you're Pedro Delgado, and you've chosen a different career than most in Segura, Spain, how do you deal with the pressure? House where all you hear is your heart pumping and all you see are the moving fingers of the starter. What are you thinking? What do you tell yourself? What do you tell your fans? Stephen Roche bears the pressure of expectation. Today is the day he must take the yellow jersey. Delgado's pressure comes from the sheer weight of the jersey. He must defend it. It has simply come down to this, the final moments before the final test in the race of truth. The clock. Two men against each other.
the end of this great race, two men separated by the narrowest of margins know the answer will come soon as to which one will go to Paris in yellow. Pedro Delgado has everything to fear now. The mountains are behind. He's a specialist time trialist. He's only been beaten once by Delgado in a mountain time trial. Today he can show his real ability, and he's off to a good start. The power, it seems, are still coming from those tired legs. 3 minutes behind, Delgado passes the most lonely moments of his sporting life. His most important time trial, with few believing he can win it. Now we shall see if he was right to try so hard in the mountains to beat Roche. Not since 1968 had there been such a climax to this race. Driven on with thoughts of winning the greatest race in the world, Roche quickly finds the important rhythm along the lonely road. After 1 kilometer, he's 5 seconds ahead of Pedro Delgado, a fighter at the best of times, who still would not give up his yellow jersey easily. But the checkpoints were all saying he would by the end. Roche, who has a French wife and lives near Paris, was being cheered all the way. These roads weren't the Alps, it was his day now. Delgado is head down, wavering a bit. He tries to limit his losses. But you can't beat Roche, who was in the mood to give back the pain he took from Delgado in the Alps. At 20 kilometers, he was already almost a minute in front. Delgado will not give up. He races as fast as he can. This race, full of surprise, could still deal a cruel blow to Roche. With just 8 kilometers to go, Roche is over a minute ahead. He's now the yellow jersey on the road, and it should be his to keep. Delgado, after a week of brilliant attacking, he now seems to have given up. At the finish, Stephen Roche completes the course in 50 minutes and 1 second. And now he has to wait for Delgado. His effort was over. Was it actually enough? While Delgado is fighting up towards the finish, the normally placid Stephen Roche finally hit back at the men who have annoyed him for 21 days. The Spaniard finished in 51 minutes and 2 seconds. It was all over for him. So at last, with a day to go, Roche is on top. Delgado is 40 seconds behind, and the rest many minutes. This is the happiest occasion for Stephen, but after so many surprise results, the emotion for wife Lydia, Nicola and Crystal is just a little bit too much. And there's a special present for Mum as well.
And we'll be back with the finish in Paris right after this.
And so early today, the Tour de France was ready to come into town. The city of Paris was waiting for the arrival of 135 survivors on this, one of the most interesting races for many, many years. The yellow jersey of Stephen Roche. He wasn't under attack all day. He just came onto the Champs-Élysées to confirm himself as the man who would win the Tour de France. Once the riders came into the city, they had to complete 6 4-mile laps up the Champs-Élysées and across the Place de la Concorde. Not surprisingly, everybody wanted to win today's stage. With only 4 miles to go, 9 riders started to break clear of the pack. And in front of them all was the American, Jeff Pierce, for the 7-Eleven team. 29 years old from Livonia, Michigan, Pierce has never won a stage in the Tour de France before. A year ago, it was an American in Paris who won the Tour de France, Greg LeMond. Now at least there was a chance for the United States to go out on a high note and win the final stage. Main field behind dropped back to 10 seconds. Stephen Roche was only interested in winning the yellow jersey. Across the Place de la Concorde, Jeff Pierce glanced for the first time over his shoulder. He would see a gap of some 5 seconds to the men chasing him home. Pierce swung into the home straight, just 200 yards to go. The pack behind had splintered, and all the way to the line, Pierce was chased by the Canadian Steve Bauer. The Tour de France was still making history. The first two riders to finish, Jeff Pierce from America, Steve Bauer from Canada. The first ever 1-2 for North America in the Tour de France. And 17 seconds later, the main field came home with Stephen Roche in the center of the pack, waving to the crowd. At last, he'd done what he promised. He'd won the Tour de France. This was also an historic day for the 7-Eleven team. They had had 3 stage wins, 2 of them by Americans in this Tour de France. And so Stephen Roche of Ireland wins the Tour de France, the time 115 hours, 27 minutes, 42 seconds, just 40 seconds in front of Delgado, with Andy Hampstead finishing 16th, the last American, Jonathan Bowyer, 98th, almost 3 hours behind. And on the podium, pulling on the yellow jersey, Jacques Chirac, the French Prime Minister. While on our left, as we look at the picture, the Irish Prime Minister, Charles Hockey, the first time an Irish Prime Minister has come out of Ireland to welcome an Irishman on top of the world in a major event. So John Dockery caught up with Stephen Roche right after the finish.
Congratulations, Stephen Roche. You have the yellow jersey. 26 days, 2,500 miles. I mean, the torture out there. Can you tell me about it?
I think it would take too long to tell you everything about it, but it's really to know what it's like, or to imagine what it's like, you have to do it, or you have to know an awful lot about cycling, because you go from zero to 2,000 meters, back down to zero again, up into the mountains again. You go through good weather, bad weather, hail, rain, and snow. You go through bad days, good days, sleepless nights, good nights. It's just a 3.5-week race with a bit of everything, and it's the survival of the strongest.
But Stephen, I'm a man who knows a little bit about pain. I saw you on top of the mountain collapse on your bike, yet you were able to recover. How do you do that?
I think it's something that I think it's one quality I possibly have in myself. I'm very, very, I recover very, very quickly, and it's something which has always helped me in stage races all through my career. That's why possibly I perform better in stage races than I do in actually one day races, because I can recover very quickly. Like at the start of the tour, I was possibly tired than I am now, because after the Tour of Italy, I was very, very tired. It took me a while to recover, and now I'm even, wouldn't say I can do another Tour de France.
But, now you, my friend, won only moments ago, won the Tour de France. You have the yellow jersey. Has it hit you yet, what it means?
Well, it actually hit me once when I was on the podium when they played the Irish National Anthem, because it's a long time since I heard it. And normally you only play it on big occasions, so I think it must be a big occasion.
This is definitely a big occasion. You are the first Irish winner ever.
Yes, but I think it's, that's not really the feat of the purpose. The feat of the thing, I think, is to win the Tour de France. First Irishman or whatever, it doesn't mean a thing, really. But to win the Tour de France is something big in itself.
What about next year?